Oh, no, I would like to request Madam Chaitra to give the presentation. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. No, I'm comfortable standing and good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for inviting me here. I'll try to keep it as brief as possible and stick to the time that has been given to me. Couple of issues that I would like to invite your attention to, because we are talking about policy framework and the way policies have been drafted. So brief actually overview is required, that how these policies have been drafted, or what rather prompted the making of various policies related to women. If we visit the ministry's website, Government of India website, there are a couple of policies which have been mentioned over there, like Beti Bachao or safe rescue homes for women, or policies related to for prevention of sexual harassment, and couple of others which have been mentioned. And I'm sure that in the workshop which is going on, a couple of these policies you must have been introduced to. Now, how do we arrive at these policies? What is the foundation? Where do they arrive from? At international level, we find that basically when this very idea of capabilities was introduced from the works of Amartya Sen, and when that was incorporated by United Nations in form of Human Development Index, there somewhere we find that idea of capability was put to some practical application as such. And then from there we moved to gender development index, gender parity index, and then certain indices were identified. I'm actually just making mention of these things because there is something else which rather I would like to emphasize. So from these various development index, parity index, or human development index, or gender development index, we got various such indices. And then also at international level, we had given our commitment to these objectives, and accordingly we have drafted various policies where we have committed to promote more gender parity. We are committed to provide more secure atmosphere to women at workplace and inside home. So we have acts related to prevention of domestic violence, or we have acts related to for the prevention of sexual harassment at work, or we have various policies for promotion of women's education, or to prevent sex selective abortion. All these policies, somewhere or the other, in background, various convention and treaties and resolutions that have been passed at an international level, they have played a very crucial role in the drafting of these policies. But actually, when these policies are drafted and when they are implemented, there are a couple of issues that we face. And rather, I would like to start from that, which was mentioned in the previous presentation, a kind of backlash which she mentioned, policy backlash. And I'm reminded of a very interesting study by Professor Carol Pateman, a very senior political scientist. And she had studied the Australian government's welfare policies. And one of these policies was the single women were given certain kind of advantages related to the norms at workplace, and there are a couple of facilities which she used to get. Professor Pateman found that when this policy came into force, it so happened that in every divorce case, the custody of the child was always given to the mother. And the father was set free in a way without any responsibility toward the child, because now the single woman has facilities and all the benefits, so she should take care of the child and not the father. So whenever we are thinking about policies and whenever we are thinking about addressing certain critical issues, these issues would rather generate to some unintended outcome also they would have. Like the very provision in the recent times about giving 6 months maternity leave. And there was a friend from corporate world and she said to me that I can never say this in public, but in our private conversation I can say this to you, with this policy in force, it will be really difficult for me to employ a woman in my organization, because if I have to give her 6 months maternity paid leave, then I'll prefer a man rather than a woman. So when we are talking about very good policies or better, very comprehensive policies or more benefits to the women, it is going to create some kind of or a very different kind of imparity, inequality or discrimination. That is something which we need to keep in mind. So when we are actually thinking about implementing various policies, it is very essential that we should be familiar about the society in which we are implementing these policies. So of course we have certain commitments to the international norms and we will follow those norms, but then my concern is, and from my area of research this concern rather becomes more, is the thinking that has taken place in India about gender discrimination, about the problems that we are women are facing. That is something which it should come to the core of the policies that are being drafted. Unfortunately, what happens is that we just use the names of the social reformers for these policies, but the content of the policy nowhere reflects the thought that has been available to us over here. So my concern is, like, when we are talking about, for instance, violence against women, are we thinking about, say, Jyotirao Phule or Dr. Baba Saheb Ambedkar? Because they were someone who had categorically spoken about the overlapping of caste and gender. So when we say how women are mutilated or how this violence goes on against women in public sphere, one of the reason is the so-called caste pride or pride of the community, and women are actually not allowed to take decisions of their own lives. Inter-caste marriages, inter-community marriages are something which are seen bad by the community, as stigma to the community, and then there is this kind of violence which takes place. I'm not saying in every case that is true, but in many cases, because of this intersectionality between caste and gender, the gender-based violence has its roots in caste discrimination also. So are we drawing something, are we actually thinking about our policies, while we are thinking about our policies, are we considering the works, the ideas about gender discrimination, about the root causes of this gender discrimination, which have been given to us by our own thinkers, our own reformers in this country. I also consider Gandhi is very crucial in this particular context, because again, when we talk about Gandhi, there is a particular stereotypical image of Gandhi which has been used. Now Gandhi is associated more with Swachhata, the idea of the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. But when we are talking about Gandhi, I would rather, in this particular context, I would rather like to address Gandhi in two different contexts. First of all, in the context of his idea of brahmacharya, when we actually want women to come in public sphere, I think this idea is very crucial, and not the way, conventionally, the way the idea of brahmacharya is understood. Gandhi's idea of brahmacharya is that when I'm in company, a man is in company of a woman, the woman should feel safe in the company of a man. So it's not just about making provisions for allowing women or facilitating women's entry in the public sphere. What would be the responsibility of a man if a woman is entering into public sphere? I will not restrain my desire. I will be the way I want. And at the same time, I'm paying lip service to so-called gender parity. If I'm not restraining myself, if I'm not changing my behavior, my attitude and my attitude towards women, then that is merely a lip service. And then Gandhi warns, because his whatever experiments that he conducted, the diary of Manu Ben is available, where he asks Manu Ben, am I not like a father to you? Do you feel like a mother? You are in the company of a mother. So idea of motherhood, like I want to reach to that consciousness when a woman in my company will not find intimidated at all. She will feel safe. That kind of a idea, that kind of a goal he had set for himself and for the men who want women in public life, or those who claim that they believe in gender equality. So I feel that this particular idea of Gandhi is very significant if we are talking about gender neutrality or gender parity or gender sensitivity in society. In another context where I would rather like to bring Gandhi in would be the idea of obedience and disobedience. And I would really like to problematize obedience in this particular way, because everybody wants their children to be obedient. We as teachers, we want our students to be obedient. Gandhi's idea is that of disobedience. So when I can be obedient, and when I need to become disobedient. The thing is, though we talk about lots of ideal things, the thing is, our children, our women, we want them to be obedient. This is my personal experience. I teach in a women's university. I get very good students, and in the third semester and fourth semester, their marriages are arranged by their families, and then they get married and they are not available to me for whatever projects maybe I have, some opportunities where I can involve them. And why? Because they are so obedient, they are so good girls that they can't tell their parents that I want to continue. I give me some more time to develop my career. We need to address this issue of obedience. Thinking about your own life, asking our parents to give us more time, asserting that I want some space for myself and I have right over my life. Is it something which is wrong? And then if some girl is doing that, are we going to call her as disobedient? Jo ulta baat karti hai, ulta jawab deti hai, then is that a paradigm in which we want to bring up our children? And if we are so much faith in that paradigm, then whatever we are talking over here is never going to percolate, it's never going to get accepted in the society, because we are then, we have double standards. We are saying certain things over there, but on the other hand, we are not actually allowing people, children, their right on their own lives. So I would really like to bring in these insights coming either from Fule Ambedkar in the context of the intersectionality between caste and gender, and also from the idea of obedience and the idea of celibacy, as Gandhi had spoken about. While concluding my presentation, I would like to share some experiences that I had while working with two different groups, and those I feel are the things which we need to do. And another experience is about the challenges that we are going to face while we are implementing all these policies. One experience is like I'm actively working with a group called Men Against Violence and Abuse. This group is a group of feminist men active more in Mumbai but all over Maharashtra, and they're actually conducting various workshops with boys and talking with them about the idea of masculinity. And masculinity is not something about aggressiveness, and how masculinity could be very humane in nature. That is something that they talk about. While conducting one such workshop in a Mumbai college, there was a student who stood up and he asked us a question. The question went on like this, that he said, "Madam, ye ladkiya hamare gents ke compartment mein aati kyun hai? Unke liye alag se ladies compartment hai, to gents compartment mein aati kyun hai? Fir idhar haath laga, udhar haath laga karke muh banati hai, daatti hai, ye kyun karti hai?" So that actually gave me the opportunity to tell him that wo gents ka compartment nahi hai, wo general compartment hai. तो इसलिए वहाँ पे कोई भी आ सकता है. और वो वहाँ पे क्यों आई है, कोई वजह होगी, शायद लेडीज़ कंपार्टमेंट तक पहुँचते पहुँचते गाड़ी छूट जाएगी इसलिए उसे चढ़ना पड़ा होगा, या कोई भी कारण होगा. जस्ट बिकॉज शी इज़ देयर डजंट मीन यू हैव द राइट और यू हैव द अपॉर्चुनिटी टू डू वॉट एवर यू वॉन्ट टू डू विथ हर. यू हैव टू रिस्ट्रेन, यू हैव टू बिहेव, ये बताने की अपॉर्चुनिटी वहाँ पे मिली. एंड इट वॉज रियली प्लेजेंट कि उनको ये समझ में आया. ही आई रियली अप्रिसिएटेड दैट ही केम आउट एंड सेड दिस इन फ्रंट ऑफ एवरीबडी. देर वुड बी मैनी जिनके मन में ये होता है लेकिन बोलते नहीं, लेकिन उसने बोलने की वजह से देर द बॉयज लेटर एक्सेप्टेड कि हाँ, ये गलत हमारे दिमाग में कुछ मिसकंसेप्शंस हैं जिनको हम ज़रूर बदलेंगे. सो One point which I would like to make over here is that we need to work with men also while we are talking about gender equality and women's empowerment. This is one thing. And second thing, the another group with which I'm working is called Mahila Rajasatta Andolan, and they have been working for a very long time. My association with them is very recent, but they are working with the women in gram panchayats, and the women who are very vocal, who are very active, who are very sharp, their experiences are that once we become active, when we become aware, when we start asking questions, we are the ones who are avoided. So a very articulate woman is somebody who is not wanted by even by her own party. Yeah. So all this, if we don't want to remain in lip service, I would rather again emphasize that we need to work with men more now to change their approaches, to change their attitudes and orientations. Thank you.